Hello, and welcome from me, Michael Scott, in Oxford in the UK. Joe Simmons is with me as well in Oxford. Welcome to from Catherine Temple, Georgetown's Catherine Temple, who is with us in Rome. Which is the last Zoom series of our Christian Literary Imagination series. That's a series created by Georgetown University's Humanities Initiative in association with Campion Hall, Oxford, and the Las Casas Institute at Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. But don't be worried, because we're going to start a new series, which I'll be announcing at the end of today's event. Today will be a little different from usual. Professor Michael Collins from Georgetown will be talking to us for about half an hour about T.S. Eliot's plays. Then Professor Catherine Temple, Father Joseph Simmons, and myself will be joining Mike for a panel debate based largely on your questions. So please send your questions on T.S. Eliot, or indeed on any of the issues raised in the series and addressed to any of us. I encourage you to participate by typing your questions directly to us from the moment we begin the session. You can do so by using your Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. Please use that button, not your chat button. If you have a question or questions, please ask them, and we will endeavor to answer them either today or later by email. But as I say, we're going to go over our usual time today if we've got enough questions. So please use your chat button, not your Q&A button. Now let me introduce Professor Mike Collins. He is Emeritus Professor of English at Georgetown University and was for many years Dean at the School of Continuing Education. He is the author of many publications on Shakespeare and other poets and writers. He is also a great teacher, and his classes have become legendary at Georgetown because of his enthusiasm and his insight, not only to Shakespeare, but Dante, Hopkins, Eliot, R.S. Thomas, John Ormond, and many, many more writers. I've had the privilege to have known Mike and worked with him since 1987. He's a good friend and an inspirational colleague with whom I've been privileged to lecture and to publish. So, having said that, over to you, Mike.
Thank you, Michael, for that very generous introduction, probably more generous than I deserve, but I do appreciate it. Thank you. I'll begin my talk right now. In the early 1950s, T.S. Eliot was widely considered the greatest living poet and the most influential literary critic in the English-speaking world. While he continued to write criticism, Eliot's reputation as a literary critic rested largely on essays he had published as many as 30 years ago, and his work as a poet had essentially come to an end with the completion of Little Gidding, the last of the four quartets, in 1943. In the years following the Second World War, Eliot abandoned poetry to write plays for the London stage. Now, as one reads Eliot's early criticism, it seems clear his idea of drama remained remarkably consistent throughout his career. Eliot's essay on four Elizabethan dramatists contains several remarkable sentences that seem to contradict not only our expectation about theater in the 20th and 21st centuries, but also the criteria by which we judge it. "The great vice of English drama, from Kidd to Galsworthy," Eliot said, "has been that its aim of realism was unlimited. In one play, every man, and perhaps in that one play only, we have drama within the limitations of art." Eliot here not only expresses his reservation about Shakespeare's achievement, but also about the achievements of such modern playwrights as Ibsen and Shaw, and in prospect, those of Noel Coward, Terence Rattigan, the celebrated English playwrights whose work Eliot would, some 30 years later, seek to emulate on the London stage. The great weakness in the drama of Shakespeare and his Elizabethan contemporaries, Eliot wrote, is the same weakness as that of modern drama. It is a lack of convention. The word convention here has a special meaning for Eliot. It is, I quote now, a form to arrest, so to speak, the flow of spirit at any particular point before it expands and ends its course in the desert of exact likeness to the reality which is perceived by the most commonplace mind. On the one hand, Eliot says, actual life is always the material. And on the other hand, an abstraction from actual life is a necessary condition to the creation of the work of art. Eliot's aesthetic values were classical rather than romantic. The poet Krzysztof Miłosz, in an essay called A Quarrel with Classicism, explains some of the implications of a commitment to classicism. As Miłosz describes it, every poet confronts the tension between convention and realism, between form and content, between the necessity of shaping words into beautiful and intelligible forms, and the necessity of portraying, as he puts it, chaotic reality with its inexhaustible richness of detail. Miłosz, if I cross out a word and replace it with another, because in that way the line as a whole acquires more conciseness, I follow the practice of the classics. If, however, I cross out a word because it does not convey an observed detail, I lean toward realism. In the end, Miłosz seems to follow Eliot the critic rather than Eliot the poet of the wasteland. As he or she tries to reconcile these two principles Miłosz proposes, quote, a poet discovers a secret, namely that he can be faithful to real things only by arranging them hierarchically. Otherwise, as often occurs in contemporary prose poetry, one finds a heap of broken images where the sun beats, Miłosz quoting The Wasteland. The Eliot who wrote The Wasteland, his most famous work, seems different from the critic who finds, as Miłosz does, that an abstraction from actual life is a necessary condition to the creation of a work of art. In a lecture he gave in a course for the teaching company, Literary Modernism, The Struggle for Modern History, Jeffrey Pearl discusses Eliot's work in philosophy. He had access to Eliot's work at Harvard. And I am drawing on it and quoting from Pearl's discussion here. As a philosopher, Eliot embraced a real relativistic epistemology. He argued that our understandings rest on our perspectives, and theories are simply theories, attempts to explain what finally cannot be explained. For Eliot, as a theory or explanation grows more adequate, it becomes more like a description, since a description better admits the complexity of what the theory seeks to explain. But Eliot, the philosopher, did not reject theory. Theoretical distinctions are all invalid, he said, and we must maintain them. That's Pearl summarizing Eliot. We need theory, Eliot affirmed, because without it, we have only a mindless accumulation of details, or as Miłosz, quoting The Wasteland, puts it, a heap of broken images where the sun beats. The goal of description and the rejection of theory in philosophy, neither of which Eliot endorsed, seemed to parallel the aim of realism and the rejection of convention in drama, and thus for Eliot to lead in both philosophy and drama only to fragments, enjoying perfect equality and hinting at the reluctance of the poet to make a choice. That's Miłosz's way of putting it. Or the philosopher to make a commitment, a heap of broken images where the sun beats. Later in the essay on four Elizabethan dramatists, Eliot explained at least one of his objections to realistic drama. I object, in other words, to the interpretation in a performance. And I would have a work of art such that it needs only to be completed and cannot be altered by each interpretation. Now, it is obvious that in realistic drama, you become more and more dependent upon the actor who brings his own understanding, his own interpretation to the role. And then, without mentioning Every Man Again, Eliot suggested one reason why he found the play to be drama within the limitations of art. A character in a conventional play, he says, can never be as real as is the character in a realistic play. Every Man rests on a set of conventions. It is allegorical, not realistic. It explains the Catholic doctrine of merit through a sequence of allegorical events and a series of allegorical characters, cousin, kindred, fellowship, good deeds, and so forth. Since the audience and the actors were part of a culture that understood what the play explained, the actors were asked only, in Eliot's terms, to complete the work of art and not to alter it by their interpretation, because its meaning was recognized and agreed upon, and it therefore needed no interpretation. As Eliot saw it, Shakespeare's plays are primarily realistic rather than conventional, and as a result, they are open to varied interpretations by actors, directors, and literary critics. Interpretations enjoying perfect equality and hinting at the reluctance of the poet, or of the critic for that matter, to make a choice. In terms of Eliot's philosophical writings, Shakespeare's plays are more descriptions of the complex, ambiguous world of our experience, rather than, like Every Man, explanations of it. But the openness of Shakespeare's plays to interpretation, their complexity of character and action, the ambiguity of their vision, their refusal to make a choice, in a word, their realism, is where critics, actors, and directors often locate their value and their greatness. What does Lear see when he asks us to look at the lifeless body of Cordelia? Is Macbeth a criminal in a morality play, or the hero of a tragedy? The world is complex. How are we to understand the Shylock who refuses to play the conventional role into which he has been cast? The answers depend upon interpretation, and the interpretations vary from reader to reader and player to player and critic to critic. Or to put it another way, the questions can never be answered, and the interpretations are, in Eliot's terms, the literary equivalent of philosophical theories, competing with one another, like all theories, to answer unanswerable questions. At the same time, as Nicholas Heitner, the former director of the National Theater, observed in an essay in the Times Literary Supplement, Shakespeare's respect for the rules of the genres in which he worked is regularly undermined by his addiction to truth, or in Eliot's terms, by his aim for realism. In Shakespeare's plays, the complexity and ambiguity of the real world repeatedly break through the conventions by which the play are shaped, the form that is meant to arrest it, preferring the ambiguity of reality to the clarity of convention, or in Miłosz's terms, the clarity of classicism. As I have tried to suggest, Eliot's reservations about Shakespeare's practices as a playwright also engage larger questions about the nature of drama in Shakespeare's time and in our own. Eliot's famous observations about Shakespeare's failure to find an objective correlative to embody Hamlet's emotions might, for example, be understood as Shakespeare's decisions to describe Hamlet's psychological condition rather to explain it metaphorically or allegorically. James Shapiro, for example, has recently proposed in 1599, the title of the book, that the differences in the second quarto of Hamlet and the first folio may have resulted from Shakespeare's attempt to shift the weight of the play from the complexity of Hamlet's consciousness to a more straightforward, coherent revenge tragedy. That is, to lessen its realism and increase its conventionality. The tension for Eliot between realism and classicism, realism and convention, seems, moreover, as I've suggested at the start, to illuminate both Eliot's practices as a playwright, the nature of the plays he wrote, and the critical response they evoke. Eliot's early criticism, in light of his commitment to theater at the end of his career, has acquired a significance that could not have been apparent when he initially wrote that criticism. As Eliot explained in a talk in 1950 at Harvard, which was published as Poetry and Drama, he had come to consider the family reunion, the first play with characters of our own time living in our world that he wrote before the war. He considered that play defective. His response was to make his next play, The Cocktail Party, not more conventional, but more realistic, eliminating lyric duets, ghosts, a chorus, and passages which called too much attention to themselves as poetry. If, as he was writing The Cocktail Party, Eliot still believed that the great vice of English drama was its aim of realism, and his remarks in Poetry and Drama suggest he did, he was, to a greater degree than he had in The Family Reunion, nonetheless embracing that vice of realism. As E. Martin Brown, the play's first director, recalled, the sets for the first production, quote, gave a good conventional Shaftesbury Avenue idea of a West End flat. The actors were dressed by the same firms who would clothe any comedy shown on the London Theatre Guide. When the curtain rose on the chatter of The Cocktail Party, no one who had not read the name of the author would suspect that anything out of the ordinary was going to happen on that stage. Eliot deliberately made The Cocktail Party seem a conventional play, but the conventions on which it rested were those of realistic theater, or more precisely, commercial West End theater in 1950. The characters in The Cocktail Party seemed the familiar upper middle class inhabitants of London drawing room comedies, a barrister and his estranged wife, a young socialite, a diplomat, a dithering old woman, a psychiatrist. And the play revolves, as the plots of such plays often do, around the romance of a young couple and the adultery and reconciliation of a husband and wife. With The Cocktail Party, Eliot, from one point of view, became a writer of realistic plays in the style of Galsworthy and Malm, Coward and Rattigan. Eliot did not, however, give himself over entirely to the vice of realism in The Cocktail Party, but rather attempted as well to respond in a realistic play to the claims of classicism, or you might say the claims of a singular meaning. As he explained in Poetry Drama, he wrote the lines of the play in a poetic form, although he also, in service to realism, put the poetry, as he said, on a very thin diet and avoided, quote, poetry which could not stand the test of dramatic utility. While he claimed the source for his story was the Alcestis of Euripides, no one recognized it, and The Cocktail Party seems essentially allegorical, shaped and driven not by realistic characters, situations, and motives, but, like every man, by the orthodox Christian vision it hopes to illustrate, the insatiable but unrecognized desire of human persons for oneness with God and the consequences for ill or for good of that desire. As the play progresses, the characters in service to that vision come to behave in unexpected ways, come to be less ordinary characters. The husband and wife experience a miraculous reconciliation. The socialite, like Teresa of Avila, embarks upon a mystical journey and is crucified protecting her patients while working as a nursing sister in a British colony. The psychiatrist, the diplomat, and the now not dithering old lady are revealed to be guardians who surreptitiously manipulate the lives of their friends so that they might reach their spiritual destination. As a playwright, Eliot thus found himself negotiating the tension Miwash describes in a quarrel with classicism, working to reconcile in his plays the claims of realism and the commercial theater with the claims of classicism and his Christian vision of the world, to reconcile what he called in poetry and drama, the dramatic and the musical order. In part because Eliot wanted to be a commercially successful playwright, he modeled The Cocktail Party on the work of playwrights like Coward and Radigan. But in the end, because he also wanted the realism of the play to suggest the significance of its vision for the world to which its audience would return, he could not paradoxically simply write realistic plays. As he said in Poetry and Drama, it is ultimately the function of art in imposing a credible order upon ordinary reality and thereby eliciting some perception of an order in reality, as every man, I would propose, did for the late medieval world. It is function of art to bring us to a condition of serenity, stillness, and reconciliation through this imposition of order, and then to leave us, as Virgil left Dante, to proceed toward a region where that guide can avail us no further. Recall, kind of suggests too, the fate of Celia in The Cocktail Party. While critics are pretty much agreed that the order in The Cocktail Party is in fact incredible, imposed incredibly upon it, implausible, imposed on the world it depicts to convey a Christian vision, revivals of The Cocktail Party all over the years have made clear the play works movingly and effectively on the stage because, ironically, if you remember what Shakespeare said about Eliot said about actors' interpretations, because ironically, the interpretation of the actors brings a recognizable human dimension to the characters, even as the audience remains unaware. The allegory is very much overlooked, remain unaware of the play's deepest religious meanings. There's an epilogue. On January 28, 2015, Tom Stoppard's new play, The Hard Problem, his first in 9 years, opened at the National Theatre in London. As one would expect from Stoppard, the play is grounded on a philosophical question, or maybe a cluster of questions. Fundamentally, what is the relationship between the brain and the mind, or the brain and consciousness? The hard problem for philosophers. At the heart of the play is a young researcher named Hillary, who investigates the hard problem at the Kroll Institute of Brain Science. Hillary is a religious person. In the second scene, before she goes to bed with her tutor, an abuse of trust, as he puts it, without precedent in higher education, one of Stoppard's one-liners, an abuse of trust without precedent in higher education, she kneels at the side of her bed to pray. As we eventually learn, Hillary gave birth to a daughter when she was 15 and put the baby up for adoption. She prays that Catherine, the baby, will, as Hillary puts it, be all right. And at the end of the play, Hillary discovers she is all right. Catherine has been adopted by Jerry, the rich American philanthropist who supports the Kroll Institute, where Hillary works. When he finds out, Jerry, as if anticipating the critics, responds, "A miracle? No, a long shot, a coincidence." The reviews of The Hard Problem were decidedly mixed. Dominic Maxwell, The Times, articulated the reservations of many critics when he wrote, "The problem of the play is that it features a lot of people who spend a lot of time debating the life of the mind and rather less time actually living much." But the miraculous revelation about Hillary's daughter also troubled the critics. Michael Arditi, the Sunday Express, for example, who characterized himself as someone, quote, of a religious bent, described the miracle as a climactic coincidence so far-fetched that it would not have been out of place in a Victorian melodrama. The critics, by and large, agreed. As Peter Kemp put it in the TLS, the miracle that Hillary prays for eventually arrives in the shape of a coincidence glaringly obvious from the start. But miracles are, by definition, far-fetched, implausible, apparently coincidental. If they were not, they would not be miracles. In his Nobel lecture in 2005, Harold Pinter described the process of writing political theater, theater that, like religious drama, has a message for its audience to take back to the world in which they live their daily lives. Here's Pinter. Sermonizing must be avoided at all costs. Objectivity is essential. The characters must be allowed to breathe their own air. The author cannot confine and constrict them to satisfy his own taste or disposition or prejudice. He must be prepared to approach them from a variety of angles, from a full and uninhibited range of perspectives, take them by surprise, perhaps occasionally, but nevertheless, give them the freedom to go which way they will. In other words, the play must be, in Eliot's terms, realistic. It must represent on the stage the apparently existential world in which the audience lives and not impose an implausible or constrictive order on that representation, as Eliot was charged with doing in The Cocktail Party. And that is the hard problem for the writer who affirms through his work a transcendent or religious dimension to the human condition. As Eliot recognized, as Pinter recognized, realism is expected. How then does a writer make realistic something that is unrealistic? How does he or she make plausible something that is inherently implausible? One might argue that Eliot or Stoppard could have been more subtle. But as Milosz pointed out, meaning and realism are perennial in tension. If you increase the one, you decrease the other. The problem I propose is endemic and insoluble in a secular society. It fuels in part the criticism of Hopkins, Eliot, Green, O'Connor, R.S. Thomas, writers whose work has been the subject of some of the talks in this series. Perhaps only those disposed to believe will find the answer to Hillary's prayer, not a last minute lurch toward emotional uplift, as Kemp put it in the TLS, not a last minute lurch toward an emotional uplift, but the intimation of a transcendent reality, if you're inclined to believe. Let me conclude by putting the problem into its simplest terms, by reading a poem by R.S. Thomas, The Country Clergy. I see them working in old rectories by the sun's light, by candlelight. Venerable men, their black cloth a little dusty, a little green with holy mildew. And yet their skulls, ripening over so many prayers, toppled into the same grave with oafs and yokels. They left no books, memorial to their lonely thought in gray parishes. Rather, they wrote on men's hearts and in the minds of young children sublime words, too soon forgotten. God, in his time or out of time, will correct this. Does the last sentence of the poem speak the truth of the human condition, affirming as it does a providential God who ultimately brings order, justice to the world? Or is it simply a last minute lurch toward emotional uplift? The answer lies not in the judgment of the critic, but in the heart of the reader. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. You've left us with a question.
That was the idea.
yeah, you really left us with a question there. I'd just like to start really with something that struck me. Every man that he says is within the limits of art. Every Man was written in 1510, or was that's the first performance we have of Every Man that we know of, is 1510. That's just 7 years before Luther nails his theses to the church. So Every Man is not just an isolated play, but it's a play within a particular tradition, the tradition of the morality plays, which were plays which came from a singular church, in the sense that we haven't got the Reformation. The Reformation begins 7 years later. So, although I'm not going to suggest that everybody in the medieval world believed that there was God and so on and so forth, I'm not going to suggest that, but I am suggesting, and or nor that there wasn't any skepticism about the church, because there must have been to lead to 1517. But I am suggesting that within the context of the public realm and the public understanding, there was at that point one Christian religion without formal dispute. And within that context, Every Man can grow, because it is a play that is talking to a general understanding of what reality is, both the reality of living and the transcendent reality of heaven, as taught by the, at that point, the one, in inverted commas, true church.
Yeah, well, whether people believed what Every Man was saying, I don't know, who knows, but what I think the point I was trying to make is it's intelligible. There's people know what, because there's a shared culture, they understand what the play is saying, whether they believe what it's saying or not. In the case of Eliot, people don't even understand what he's trying to say. But it's very clear if you read the reviews of the plays of the Cocktail Party, nobody knows what's going on in that play. They really don't. But I want to get back to something about Every Man, is that Every Man is fighting its own war within that larger culture, because what it is, it's a defense of the doctrine of merit, which was under attack even before Luther puts his 95, was it, thesis?
Yeah.
Hammers them up. The doctrine of merit was under attack. You know, going back to and the idea of justification through faith, through the inability of human beings to in any way justify themselves through their actions, the doctrine of merit was even under attack at that time. So Every Man is working, is responding to a controversy within the church, but there is no formal rift. The church is still the single church, but within it are these strains of theological differences, and Every Man is responding to one of those theological questions.
But it ends with the doctor giving the church's doctrinal position to something which is absolutely true, that Every Man is going to die.
There is the overarching allegory. You know, he meets death and he will die. But then there's the underside of the allegory about the doctrine of merit. Yeah. See, good deeds is flat on her back, and she's used to him. He goes to confession, sanctifying grace. In what animates or his good deeds, and there's a real theological allegory within the play as well.
Well, leads beautifully to another question, which I know is something because we've written about each other over the last year or so, and that is the whole nature of allegory and theatre. every man is allegorical. Do you think that the later drama that developed after the Reformation, which kind of reaches its peak, I suppose, with Shakespeare, do you think that that is allegorical, or do you think by the time it gets to Shakespeare, the allegory has all disappeared?
I think there are allegorical elements in Shakespeare, you know that, and there's maybe not so much explicit, you know, for example, what is the relationship between Hal and Falstaff allegorical? You know, the vice figure, and is that just an allegory of the way human beings are, or are we to understand it more as a particular relationship between the prince and then how are we to understand that relationship? Because some people, Harold Bloom, for example, thinks Falstaff is a wonderful person, the heart of life and liberty and so on. So the point, what happens with Shakespeare, at least for us, as we read him, is we see possibilities in there that we see them in every man as well. I'm not trying to suggest that, but they're much more open, Shakespeare's plays, to various understandings than every man would be. I would like to say one thing just in general, because I think it's remarkable. If you read, not that remarkable is the wrong word, but if you read theater criticism, you know, New York Times, London Times, if you write a play that is in any way implausible, it is always criticized. Now, you read reviews every day, you hear critics saying, but then the play breaks down, or it seems to be that people are making points without being really human. You know, it's not human conversation, it's people having a debate. Whenever the realism starts to give way and the play seems to be trying to make a point, that's when it gets criticized. I think that, you know, that's my opinion, my conclusion from reading a lot of reviews. I should be a little careful. In a certain kind of realistic theater.
Oh, okay. Because I was going to say
Arthur Miller, not Samuel Beckett.
Yeah. Okay. Because I was going to say, I wondered whether it was just a millennium issue that, or because if you went back to post-war Europe and you got Beckett and you got UNESCO and Adamov and so on.
That's a different. A different tradition, but if you're working the way Miller, Pinter, well, Pinter to some degree, if you're working in that tradition, then implausibility is a great crime.
I know Catherine Temple's going has sent in a message, but I think Catherine, you might as well come in online to ask the question. And whilst you're doing that, I'll just raise something else, which is to do with naturalism, because Eliot is writing not just in terms of popular realism that you're going to talk about with, you know, the plays of Rattigan and Noel Coward and so on and so forth, but the actual the really kind of intellectual drama that was coming through from the end of the 19th century. Was that of Ibsen and Strindberg, you know, following the call from Zola to have a naturalism in theatre. Yet, what interests me on that is that someone like Ibsen in writing Ghosts was writing ghosts more to be read than was writing ghosts to be performed. So the naturalism that he was seeing in his mind was to do with the reader understanding something, almost as if it was a novel written in a different form, rather than something that was going to be impersonated by actors on stage. Because once you put an actor on the stage, then realism goes, because the realism is being mediated through a three-dimensional body on the stage, which is not necessarily the same as the written character that you've put in the play.
I read the reviews of the 1970. I read a lot of reviews about the cocktail party, but I read all of them on the 1997 production. And that's right. What the critics were interested in were the characters, the nature of the psychiatrist, Riley, the nature of mostly of the husband and the wife and the psychiatrist, and the kind of, and they paid a certain lip service to, they said something like, a Christian vision and so on, but fundamentally the play was about these people in a secular world. Eliot's vision never got articulated, or if it on the stage, I think they just ignored it.
maybe it couldn't, because it was a play. But Catherine's joined us, so Catherine, do you want to ask your question?
I had another question, or more related to what you were just talking about, which was, I have a friend who does theater research in the legal environment, and one thing she writes about is the way that a mistake on stage, or some kind of departure from what is supposed to be happening, somebody drops something or they forget their lines, actually contributes to the realism of the rest of the play. And I just wondered what you thought about that idea.
A friend of mine, Stephen Booth, always said that what was most interesting to audiences when they were aware, made aware through some way or another, when they were made aware of the fact they were watching a play, that it enhances, in some way it enhances their enjoyment of it. Falstaff walks off the stage carrying his sword, and then he drops it by his side, and the audience catches sight of him coming out of character. And the actor and not the audience. That was the moment. Those were the moments when audiences most enjoyed, most enjoyed the production. I'm not sure he ever said. I'm not sure about the whether it kind of made the whole thing more realistic. But he said it's those moments on the stage where an audience almost accidentally becomes aware that get jolted out of there. This illusion of reality, that's when the play becomes most meaningful and enjoyable to them. And Shakespeare builds that in. When Polonius forgets his lines, people always say, the night I saw it, Polonius forgot his lines. But Polonius forget his lines, it's built into the play. He's supposed to forget his lines. Moment is telling the audience, it jolts the audience, it makes them it engages them. He forgot his lines, and I'm sure Shakespeare built it in not just to show that Polonius is an old fuddy duddy, but also that he built in to create that impact on the audience.
I got an anecdote about that you might like, that I was watching a production of Richard II, Royal Shakespeare Company production of Richard II at Newcastle upon Tyne. And it was Alan Howard playing Richard. And you remember the scene where Richard stops the tournament. He throws his warder down, right? So his warder's like a kind of staff of office. He throws his warder down in order to stop the tournament. And then he's got a speech. And as he threw it down, the warder started to roll down the stage, right? So the warder went down the stage. Meanwhile, Howard, completely in part, followed it, giving his speech. He's coming down, and everybody in the audience could see it coming down in front of him, and it fell off the edge of the stage, right? Howard came to the edge of the stage as Richard II, and some poor lady in row A stood up, picked up the water, and handed it to him. But he was in his path. He just totally ignored her. You do not do that to a king. He just turned around, and she was left holding it in front of the whole of the audience. It was one of the most theatrical moments of my witness in theatre. It was wonderful.
My story is Gloucester's eye rolling down the stage.
Oh no!
The entire National Theatre production, the entire house just—they forgot about Gloucester. Everybody's eye as it rolls down.
Remarkable.
So interesting, though, to think about those moments as increasing the enjoyment of the rest of the play as a play.
Yeah.
Right? Because those are moments of disorder, and then you get to re-enter the world of the play where everything is ruled by conventions and is, you know, especially in the case of Shakespeare, completely predictable since we've all seen those plays a million times, right? So it's just, there's like a difference between like the danger of things going wrong in the real world versus the safety of the theatrical performance, I think is really interesting and probably is part of what people enjoy. And they enjoy moving back and forth from those two, among those two different worlds between them, right? I was just so interested in what Eliot was saying about convention. I just found it, Bruce, I haven't read a lot of Eliot's criticism, and I found it fascinating that he thought that writers should remain within conventions, and the point of conventions was to keep you from going off into the wild or something like that. Words actually used. And I started thinking, well, is it possible to escape convention? I mean, aren't we just bound by these conventions that are even unconscious and we don't even realize, you know, what they are? And that seems to me somewhat connected to this Christian literary imagination where we, you know, find it everywhere. Right, and it's because it's become a kind of convention in Western literature. I don't know, these are some of the random thoughts I was having about this.
It's this isn't really in response to what you're saying, but what's odd about Eliot is, of course, The Wasteland.
Which?
It's not really formless, but, you know, it appears to be formless. There's a bunch of fragments thrown on the sheet. And then at the same time he's writing The Wasteland, he's writing this criticism in which he says, convention is, without convention, you have nothing, you know? So it's a very odd, maybe it's true that Eliot wrote a more conventional play and then Ezra Pound changed it all. So I don't know.
It strikes me, if I can weigh in, that even to kind of subvert conventions or push against the constraints is itself an appeal to those constraints. It's saying, I'm rejecting these. Well, you're rejecting something. So I think maybe his point being that you're always responding either positively or negatively to the constraints that that you've encountered. And so I think to that extent, he's on the mark there.
Do you think in that context, Mike, within the does the wasteland confront what Conrad calls the horror that the plays don't confront, or do you think the plays do confront that?
I guess what The Wasteland is about is, I kind of think, you know, the conventional way it's understood, the fragmentation that befalls Western civilization after the First World War, probably well expressed. So, you know, The Wasteland does as good a job as any of those plays to suggest that. Now, what Eliot believed and how much of, how much that was manipulated by Ezra Pound and all those questions, I don't know. I leave that to the scholars of Eliot, and I am not one. But the the plays, the Cocktail Party at least, is a Eliot says is a comedy, and it ends happily because the husband and wife are reconciled. They understand what it means to live a human life, you know, avoid excessive expectation, be satisfied with the morning that separates and the evening that brings together by the fire. And then Celia finds what she's searching for in ultimately in her martyrdom. We're to believe that she has found God and oneness with the divine, which is what she sets out to achieve when Riley sets her on the mystical journey.
Yeah, interesting. John Ford Rescher has joined the conversation. Hi, John. It's lovely to hear from you. And he says, the wasteland ends with God speaking through the thunder and explaining everything. Ultimate imposed meaning.
I would say to John that God explains it. What did he say? I don't know.
Yeah, maybe John will come back to us on that.
That's Tom Stoppard and the baby who was adopted. Deus ex machina, the God solves the problem.
Yeah. Joe, let's go to you. What do you now consider to be the Christian literary imagination? Are you in the same place that you were before, the 2 years ago when we started this series, or have you changed your views at all?
Well, I would say this much. I mean, I began the series back in October of 2020 saying it was going to be like roller skating through the Louvre. And I think there's something to that. There's such a variety of presentations that we've had. And I would go back to the basic insight, though, that I mentioned earlier, which is William Lynch's insight that what makes it Christian is not talking explicitly or implicitly about Jesus, but it's that it's engaging in concrete particularities of what is real, what is life itself. And I referred to James Wood then, and I was thinking about it even in light of today when we were talking about Eliot's plays, that he talks about realism as lifeness, not necessarily just trying to create a veridical a play, but is he says, I grabbed this off my shelf when Mike was speaking. Wood says that realism, seen broadly as truthfulness to the way things are, cannot be mere verisimilitude, cannot be mere life-likeness or life-sameness, but what I must call lifeness, life on the page, life brought to different life by the highest artistry. And it cannot be a genre. Instead, it makes other forms of fiction seem like genres. For realism of this kind, lifeness is the origin. And I think that what that is, what he's getting at there is to take concrete particular seriously, even when the water bottle rolls down the stage or the eyeball of Gloucester rolls down the stage, there's sort of an awareness in the audience that these are human actors performing this story here. And that we too are human actors performing stories, and the characters in the novels have something of lifeness to them. And so in so much as these are incarnated by real people and the real questions that people have, I think everything we've been looking at in this series goes back to that question of lifeness and taking concrete human questions seriously. So that would be an initial thought, kind of a focusing on what makes these things Christian in the sense of William Lynch's understanding is that they engage in incarnation, the real life and blood, warp and woof of everyday life for people. That would be one initial thought that I have.
Yeah. Catherine, what do you think?
Well, I wasn't sure how the series would evolve. I think at the beginning, I sort of had a Colleen Parsons reaction from last week, which was, you know, what would be said, what could be said about this? And I went back last week when you raised this question and looked at like research in the last 20 years in the MLA bibliography that mentioned Christian literary imagination or just Christian and literary in the same context. And there's very little work on it. So I think one reaction I have now is how impressed I am by the fact that we, meaning you, Mike, brought together 25 papers, you know, all of them excellent on this topic, right? And I guess the other thing that I realized over time was I think the the Christian literary imagination exists on a continuum, right? We have had work that's been, you know, very specific. Here is somebody talking about God, talking about Christ, talking about belief, talking about what it means to have faith. Is faith imagination or is faith through reason? You know, all of this, these kinds of questions, and all the way to just the incarnation, right? Or maybe the desire for something greater than the self, right? So that we see some of the scholars talking about depth as a representation of Christianity, or talking about the heavens in the sense of astronomy and science, you know, as representing something that they're seeking or yearning for. So rather than having it be one thing, having it be really constrained by conventions, it seems, at least in Western literature, you know, as you were saying, Joe, it's either, you know, it's being played out in different ways. The stories are being played out in different forms, maybe with no reference at all to God or Christianity. They're being played out through various symbols that have just become part of the way that we think about the world in the West. So I'm now more, you know, I've gone from thinking what is there to thinking what isn't there. You know, it's like when you have not seen a particular word and for a long time, and then all of a sudden it shows up everywhere you look. So it's been a very interesting process, very rich.
I think to your point, Catherine, I think there's this Dominican early 20th century Marie Dominique Chenu who was saying in an article called "Literature as a place lieu de of theology," and he says that scripture has been kind of taken or understood historically as this is the patrimony of the church, this is for the church, but it's so suffused Western culture that it in fact is not the exclusive domain of religious-minded people or people who say, I look to scripture for truths of the faith, but it's sort of woven into the fabric of the references that are made, you know, drawing from the period that Michael would be going right up until today. And so we can't really lay a claim on this and say, well, no, this is, it's hard to kind of draw a line between what constitutes sacred or what constitutes secular scripture as a result of that. And so it's so suffused in the culture that it fades into the background. And so some of the people we were listening to in this series have brought it out more to the fore and said, okay, these are the explicit Christian implications. Here are the references that it does. But then last week, as we were talking with Colleen about Olive Schreiner, there were references that resonated with a Christian vision or a conception of the heavens as sort of where God says, you know, to Abram, you know, you will have descendants as numerous as the stars, in that same sense of awe and wonder, you know. So we might read it from a Christian lens and say, ah, okay, I see the Christian ramifications of that or the outworkings of that. And others might say, well, I don't really see that, but it's because those references are so deeply embedded in our culture, I think, that we don't even necessarily recognize them as religious as such.
Yeah. I mean, that was one thing we talked with Colleen about. Has the world become so, our world at least, become so secular that we don't recognize the importance of these issues to, say, an 18th century writer, you know, a mid 19th century writer, because we're not reading for it. I mean, I do have to, Mike, do you think Eliot really meant that literature should be written in such a way, or theater should be written so that there could only possibly be one interpretation? I think I gather that from what you said.
I imagine, I think realistically you realize that I think that was a theoretical position. I think when he got into the theater, it became very clear that you know, that's not the way it works. But there is embedded in the cocktail party, for all of its realism, whatever, however you define that, there is an allegory there, which is a very orthodox Christian allegory. We, you know, the reason why everybody's miserable is because we mistake the good in our world. You know, we look to other people to give us what only God can give us, what the sense of oneness and with another person, the idea that we all long for God, and we destroy other people because they don't give us what we want. You know, it is a lot of what of very traditional or orthodox Christian theology at play in that, and I think that's what he, I don't know what he wanted. I don't know what he expected. That's hard to know whether he ever expected anybody could bring it out. But what the critics at least responded, and he wanted to be a popular playwright. The critics responded, so Alan Guinness did a great job as Riley in the first in the initial production of the play. Alex Guinness said, "Oh, wonderful," and blah blah blah, and you get the kind of criticism that any play would get that misses the fundamental point of what Eliot is doing. Now, whether that allegory can actually ever be articulated on the stage, who am I? But I'm not sure. I'm not sure you can do that.
Well, yeah, and I think that makes the point that Joe and I were talking about. Like, you know, how do you recognize where and when it's the Christian literary imagination? You know,
yeah, it's
look at my theory about it.
If you're not disposed and you don't know the theology, the whole thing's lost on you. Mm-hmm. Where is
it possible to not know? I mean, you may not know the theology, but is it possible to not know the basic storylines, right? If you think of a lot of Christian narrative, it seems like it's everywhere.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
Everybody is, and I don't know why. I've only seen the play once, and the night I saw it, when they mentioned that Celia's been crucified, everybody says, "Oh, that's implausible. That's horrifying. That's the tone is all wrong." So they're making critical judgments on it, whereas the audience was sat there. You could hear a pin drop in the theater. People were just silenced by the reality, the human reality of the thing. So, Eliot set himself a task that I don't think he could achieve. Because of the theatrical world and the real world in which he was working. It's a secular world. Theatrical world has a set of expectations, and he's not going to work. The last thing that I said, not meaning to quote myself, but the answer's in the heart of the reader, of the person in the audience. It's not in the judgment of the critic.
Mike, there's one play that you've ignored, really, and that's Murder in a Cathedral. Would you like to say something about that?
Well, I'll say what Eliot said is it's a fine play. I think he said he should have put the sermon in poetry as well. But what he said about it, it was a good play, but it was a play for people who were disposed to those kind of plays. It takes place during some kind of a religious festival, or I can't remember the exact context of it, but it was in a religious context that the play was first performed. And he said these are the people who come to these kind of plays expect to hear poetry and expect to hear religious sentiments being expressed and so on. But that didn't satisfy him. Because apparently, and it's hard to figure out what's going on. Is it that he really just wants to be like Radigan and be a successful playwright and hang out with the actresses, or is he? He also says, "I want the vision to be. I want people to see that religious dimension of human experience doesn't just exist back in Beckett's day. It's in our own time, in our own world. So I have to write my plays reflecting that world in order to bring the audience to see that the vision is meaningful in the world that the audience returns to." I think that's the way he puts it, that it means something in the world that the audience returns to. So that's one reason why he opted for the realistic theater. so that people would realize that, you know, what's back in 12th century, the religion isn't just some 12th century phenomena. God is present and working in our, in the world in which we live, in the upper middle class society in London.
Okay, so that leads to something else, which Director Joe, I think, the Christian imagination, when a writer is labeled Christian, so here's Eliot, he writes The Murder in the Cathedral, which is a Christian play, Christian festival, all the rest of it, Christian conscience and so on coming in. The Beckett has a crisis. Should he carry on and be martyred? Is that some kind of pride and all the rest of that kind of thing that is going on? A Christian play. Is there a difference between writers who write novels who happen to be Christians or happen to be Catholics, and writers who write from a specific point of view of trying to put forward their Christian doctrine? Joe.
Well, that's a $64,000 question. I think there are some who are explicit in what they're doing. And so with somebody like Eliot, there was a sense of needing to re-Christianize or make people aware of the Christian underpinnings. And I think of in Dryce of Ages, he says, you know, we had the experience but missed the meaning, and approaching the meaning restores the experience in a different form. So he's sort of identifying that maybe the deeper cultural meanings of these stories has been lost. And so we need to kind of reapproach the meaning in a sense in order to help us better understand all of the story. So that would be one take on things. I think there are others who write, I think of like a Cormac McCarthy, who would kind of reject sort of the trappings of Catholicism, and yet he would still be operating out of a deeply apocalyptic vision in a lot of his rather dark fiction. But it's still drawing from the religious roots. And so I think of Graham Ward, who's spoken in our series on Thomas Traherne and some of the metaphysical poets. Mm-hmm. And he says, like, you really can't have a secular fiction because you're always drawing upon and conjuring images from a religious background. So whether you do it explicitly or not, intentionally or not, you are drawing from that. And so perhaps the breakdown would not be, I'm a Christian writer trying to convert people to a Christian viewpoint, or I am not a Christian writer and I'm trying to do something different, but we're all sort of drawing, we're all swimming in the same soup. And so we're drawing on these, and it's a matter of whether it's being done explicitly and consciously or not. That might be one stab at the question, or a different way of slicing up that pie. I don't know, and I'm open to being challenged on that, but that's
just... What do you think Mark Bosco would say about Graham Greene on that?
Well, I think he would say, as an expert on both Flannery O'Connor and Graham Greene, Flannery O'Connor was very clearly like, you know, in a time when people are deaf, you need to shout. So you have characters who are overdrawn and outsized as a way of kind of shouting to a culture that maybe has forgotten or unaware of its Christian roots or sense of God. I think Graham Greene was sort of writing in spite of his Catholicism much of the time. He was sort of troubled by it, and his fiction was used as a laboratory for playing out these questions of religious belief or non-belief. But it's interesting, if you look at End of the Affair, for example, there's sort of this weird seduction going on, and it's not towards another affair, but it's a seduction towards faith experienced in, I'm forgetting her name, the woman in there. It's told from the perspective of Maurice watching the conversion of his lover. And the atheist who's out in the middle of Clapham Common is sort of deliberately disfigured and kind of an ugly figure. So he's sort of aware that he's sort of stuck between these poles of unbelief and belief. And he finds that his character Maurice sort of deals with resentment at the fact that somebody else would be falling in deeper in love with God. And so we sort of see in Green, I think at least, an attraction, but also a revulsion to the question of faith. So I think a Flannery O'Connor and a Graham Greene would be approaching those questions differently. I don't know if I have any taxonomy though to chart out the different characters and the different ways of approaching that. I don't know if anyone else has thoughts on that.
I haven't read Graham Greene since college, which I'm embarrassed to say how many years ago that was. And I was thinking about both Flannery O'Connor and Graham Greene, and that when I read them in college, to me, the Christian imagination exhibited there seemed beside the point, right? And I know that's a ridiculous misreading, right? But I think that's how, you know, sort of sign of the secularization that I'm talking about, that it was possible for me as a 20-year-old to read those books and pass by the spiritual elements and think about them more like when I, you know, think about Flannery O'Connor's stories, A Good Man Is Hard to Find, some of those stories, and see them as really stories about the impossibility of redemption for human beings, but not in a Christian context. And I just find that now, when I look back on that 20-year-old self, I just find that fascinating. I don't think I could read them that way today, certainly not after the series.
Well, thanks for that. Just something that was going through my mind whilst asking that was, in his early days, Pinter refused to admit anything political in his plays. He said the people said he was apolitical. He didn't comment on it. But when he was actually confronted by it, and they said, somebody said, "Are you apolitical?" And he said, "To say that I am apolitical would be a political statement," you know. And I just wonder whether that goes with the Christian writers as well. Look, folks, we're coming to towards the end of this terrific talk. Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Catherine. Thank you, Joe, for getting involved. And thanks, John Ford Rashid, for getting involved. One of our writers in the series. It's been a terrific session. With the next series, which we're going to begin on the 11th of October at 4 p.m. BST, 11 a.m. US time. This will be on literature, art, and the environment. And I think in a sense that it's evolved from this series that we've had on the Christian literary imagination, which all came about through a conversation that Father Joe Simmons and I had after a dinner which had taken place after a lecture in the Christian Shakespeare question mark series. And I think there is a continuity of thought coming through with us in terms of the kind of series that we want. So we've gone to something else that we want to talk about literature, we want to talk about art, and we want to talk about the influence of the environment. And actually what we've been talking about in this discussion has largely been about the environment, different environments producing certain work, or at least influencing certain work. So I hope people in the audience are very grateful to you for being with us for so long. I've just been at another event down at Blackfriars, and Emmy came up to me and introduced herself to me. Emmy, thank you very much, because you've been one of the people all the way through. You haven't put in any questions, but you expressed your delight in the series. So thank you, Emmy, and thank all of you who've been like Emmy and been with us through the series. Can I remind you that there's another Zoom next month, which is in the Free Speech Project. The Free Speech Project will continue through the summer, just one a month. And it's going to be on censorship, and that's on the 6th of June at 4 p.m. BST, 11 a.m. EST. And one other thing that you ought to know, especially if you're living in the UK, is that on Tuesday, the 13th of December, we will be holding a one-day conference here in Oxford. It'll be at the University Catholic Chaplaincy in Rose Place on the Christian literary imagination. And we've got papers from distinguished scholars both in the UK and the US. And keynotes from Timothy Radcliffe, who many of you will know, a terrific theologian, but also a literary buff here in Blackfriars. And also from the former Archbishop of Canterbury, Dr. Rowan Williams, who gave that wonderful talk in the Christian Shakespeare question mark series on the Merchant of Venice. So they've already signed up to this, and other people have signed up to be giving papers during that that one day conference on Tuesday the 13th of December. The day before, if any of you are doctoral students, postgraduate students, we're having a symposium, which Joe is organizing at Campion Hall. So there'll be 2 days going on, but that's a symposium for graduate and postgraduate students, again, on the Christian literary imagination. I'd like to thank very much Joe, who has been such a stalwart with this. We've had conversation after conversation, and I'm afraid our loss in Oxford is going to be Georgetown's gain, because Joe has accepted a position of his fellowship at Georgetown from September. But Joe, thank you so much for all the work you've done. Catherine, I'd like to thank you, because behind the scenes, you've done a tremendous amount. You've been feeding the questions in. You've been so loyal. And I've also been able to bounce ideas off you as we've gone through the year, and indeed bounced ideas off you for the next series already. Mike, as ever, we've been debating these things through the year. So I'm very grateful to you, and I'm very grateful to the administrators, to Julia Murillo, Mary Gordon in particular, who have done a terrific job in helping us. Of course, it wouldn't have happened if Dr. Jack DeJoya, the president of Georgetown, hadn't decided that he would like it to happen when we put the ideas to him, and also to Tom Banchoff, the vice president of Global Affairs. So thank you to both of them. To Campion Hall, thanks to Nick Austin, the master of the hall, and Sarah Gray, who sadly is retiring. We wish her a happy retirement. And to Ying Ying, our Campion Hall administrators. Blackfriars, to Richard Finn, the director of the Las Casas Institute, to John O'Connor, the regent, and to King Girona Gabnai, the administrator. I can't thank Maggie, my wife, enough for helping with the administration. She's been absolutely terrific, and she must have realized I was just going to say something like that, because she just walked out the room. Anyway, but thank you to Maggie. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you to you. Thank you for all the questions that have come in. Thank you for the series. And we look forward to seeing you again on Tuesday, the 11th of October, for our new series on literature, art, and the environment. In the meantime, don't forget, free speech carries on, of course, each month. But in the meantime, have a really good summer and keep safe. I'm Mike Scott. Please follow me on Twitter at Mike Scott Prof. Thank you. Thank you and goodbye.